Welcome to the Elevate Your Equity Podcast, where we, as married busy professionals, leverage real estate investing to unlock the 3+1 degrees of freedom, health, location, time, and financial.
Today, we've got a true powerhouse on the show with us. Super excited to have Mr. Mike Ayala on the show. How are you today, Mike?
Man, I'm so excited to be here. And I'm just happy that I'm getting to spend some time with you when you could be out in Santorini exploring. So,
yes, sir. Thank you so much. Well, this is a trade that I would do gladly, just because, you know, talking with someone that has done so much in such a relatively short period of time, even though it's been a really long term type of success pattern, definitely am excited to learn some pearls of wisdom and ask you some very pointed and related questions that may or may not apply to our current situation right now. So in a way, it may be a little bit selfish, but hopefully the listeners and you will be able to take something away from it as well. So for the people that don't know you, Mike, you're an investor, speaker, podcaster, and founder of Investing for Freedom. Mike also helps busy professionals and business owners find the true freedom to live their best life. And he's the co-founder of Four Peaks Capital Partners, LLC. His role includes operations, management teams, development, and being the chief people officer. And he also co-directs the overall investment strategy, which is super cool. We're probably going to be extracting some pearls of wisdom there too. And Mike's got over 22 years of experience in finding freedom by building teams and streamlining operations. That is quite a mouthful, Mike, but I know that you've definitely deserved it because you have a long resume. I want to try to keep it as succinct and as focused as possible. So there we go. So, you know, Mike, the first thing that we'd like to do with a lot of our guests is to basically ask, how did you get inspired or how did you start in real estate investing in general?
You know, I started my real estate investing journey started with my business journey. I started a plumbing and heating company at the age of 24. And I've always been, you know, even the intro, like I didn't write that. I've always been the dumb kid in the corner, like honestly, and everybody's always like, but the reality is like, I'm always looking for someone smarter than me. I'm always looking to be in that bigger room, that smarter room. And I actually think that's the key to success in general. So when I started our company at the age of 24, I realized like I was a plumber, but I had no business experience. I didn't know what the heck accounting was. I didn't even know what an accounting software looked like. And so from the very beginning, I was so in over my head that I just constantly was looking for the best coaches, the best mentors. And getting to real estate, I actually found an HVAC and plumbing industry coaching company called Business Development Resource. And we can circle back to all of this, but I went to a 3-day planning event probably after coaching with them for 6 or 7 months. And this was probably 2005 at this point. And the entire first day was all about, you know, achieving your goals. And my head coach was actually speaking to this room of 100 business owners. And he said, if your business isn't helping you achieve your personal goals, you just own a job. And that entire first day was all about like, what do you really want life by design to look like? And at the age of like 25, I'm like kind of just getting exposed to this whole thought process. You know, Karen and I had set goals, like we want to get a new couch and that kind of stuff, but they really forced us to think about, you know, if money and time wasn't an issue, what would your life look like? What would you have? And this is where the real estate comes in. We set a goal of 2 income producing properties a year for 10 years. That was kind of like, in my mind at that point in time, I'm thinking, man, if I could just get 20 properties over the next 10 years, by the time I'm 65 years old, they'd all be paid for and I could retire, right? So we came back that year, we bought 2 income producing single families. And then the next year I fell into this mobile home park deal and it just kind of set me on this journey of buying real estate. So.
Oh, that's awesome. So it sounded like a lot of this is preceded by mindset. I like how you started there just because that seems to be the common theme that we hear from a lot of our guests as well. And it seems like that was one thing that you really kind of settled into. So can you talk a little bit about the mindset shift that you had at age 25 and how long it took to build that mindset up? Or was it more of like an instant thing? Can you talk a little bit about what it was like in the early days?
Yeah. So, you know, the crazy thing is, and this will sound counterintuitive, but the reality is like the more ego that you have, the less you're willing to ask for help. And, you know, there's like this preconceived idea that, you know, the more successful we get, like people are egocentric and wealthy, successful people are greedy. And I think it's the opposite. Like the most egocentric people that I know are the ones that don't want to ask for help. And that's a downward spiral into getting stuck exactly where you're at. And so the mindset around, I think, growth and performance and wealth building, successful business, successful real estate, all of the above, is laying your ego down on the table and asking for help. And there's two things that I can really say. Number one, I don't have a problem offering help. And I also don't have a problem asking for help. It's harder for me to ask for help, especially when it's like, hey, can you, you know, do something for free for me? But I love the Zig Ziglar quote, you can have everything you want in life if you just help enough other people get what they want. And I didn't know the quote back then. I actually, the quote that I would have said before is, a scripture out of the Bible that I really love. With the same measure you give, it'll be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give back to you. And so I've always just kind of adopted that mindset. So back to the mindset thing, the reality is the more we think we know, the less you're going to gain, the shorter your distance is going to be in life. And so when we get curious and we start telling ourselves, what don't I know? What am I missing? Like, who do I need in my life? All of those types of questions. That's the most important thing when it comes to mindset and success, in my opinion.
Such a profound and it's just gold right there. I really, really appreciate you saying that because, you know, for me, what it reminds me of is whenever you're having a conversation with someone that maybe you just meet, maybe that's in a peer group of yours, there's always one person that's doing a lot of the talking and not really listening. Another quote that I heard is that we were created with two ears and one mouth, so we should be listening two times more than we're talking. And I found that always to be true. The people that want to sound intelligent are the ones that are trying to hide behind some of these barriers of puffing their chest out and trying to become or put the illusion on that there's someone bigger. And the people that are really going places are the ones that are generally curious and able to put their ego aside. And I just absolutely love that you said that. So thank you for bringing that up. That's good stuff there. Let me ask you too. So, you know, you've had a very diverse career. You've gone through a lot of, you know, you've grown a lot of different businesses, and I don't think that there's any end of that coming. And I just don't think that that's in the cards for you. I think that you're going to continue growing. And what would you say the one skill set that you have leveraged throughout all of those businesses in the past 22 years? I know there's a lot there, but what one skill set would you say has been the common thread across all of your ventures and helped you scale?
Everything that you need in life is on the other side of a person. And it took me a while to anchor this, but even starting that business, and part of this was luck, part of it was timing, but a big part of it was knowing where my limitations were. And so when we started that business in 2004, you fast forward 4 years, 5 years, we're on the Inc. fastest growing companies in America in 2009. Even when we started that business, so we actually got our contractor's license in May or June of that year. By the end of that year, I think we had 19 employees and we were doing almost $1 million in revenue in like 6 months. And so we were on this explosive, I didn't know it was explosive at that point in time. I really had no, again, I was the dumb kid in the corner. And I don't say that facetiously. Like, I just didn't know what I didn't know. But I was just doing, like, when my coach would say, do X, Y, Z, I'll never forget going to, you know, trainings and conferences. And I can't tell you how many people, and it's the same people that want to talk that you were just talking about a few minutes ago. I can't tell you, we'd be in a room of, you know, 60 or 80 business owners, and you'd be sitting around a table. And I can't tell you how many business owners would be saying to the coaches, the experts, the top one or two coaching companies in the world in their trade, I can't tell you how many owners would say, oh, that'll never work in my market, or that my customers will never go for that. And it's what you think you know, like Mark Twain says, that really isn't so, that'll get you into trouble, right? And so from an early age, at that age, like, I was on this explosive growth trajectory. I didn't know, like I said, I was just doing exactly what my coach would tell me. And this is a horrible way to say it. I don't say it this way anymore, but what I was doing at that point in time was stacking bodies. I was just looking for, you know, anybody with a heartbeat. I've learned so much more since then about, you know, hiring slow and firing quick. And just, I love the Dream Manager book. It's probably one of my all-time favorite books because it's really about, and we can circle back to this because I think it's important. You know, when you really think about empowering your employees and figuring out, you know, what they want out of life, that's kind of the thread of Dream Manager. But when I look backwards, those are kind of the one thing, like you were talking about, if you put it above everything else, if you hire the right vendor, coach, employee, whatever it is that you need, business partners, even, I'm a huge fan of partnering because, you know, if you got two people that have equity in the game or three or five or 10 or 100, we can get so much further faster. So if you really come down to it, everything that you're missing is on the other side of a human. It might be advice, it might be wisdom, it might be needing their time, it might be needing their money, it might be needing their connections. And when we get into that frame of reference, again, this comes back to ego and scarcity mindset, I'm an open book. I'll share with anybody. I was on a call the other day with a guy who's fastly scaling in the mobile home park space. There is so much abundance. Like you can't, I heard this saying a long time ago, but you can't outgive God. And it's true. Like just the abundance. But again, everything you need's on the other side of a human. So when you really show up and just add value with no expectation back, that all continues to come back to you. So everything you need can be summed up on the other side of a person.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. Is there anything that you can add in terms of processes behind people to help empower your people? Like, is there anything that you do from a process-driven standpoint to help automate things? Because I know that you can always add someone to help with your business, but how important is it also to have processes involved with the growth that you're incurring?
So this is kind of an interesting question because it does come back to a who for me, because I'm not a
process. Oh, yeah.
I'm a visionary guy. And so I do believe huge in process, but I've had to learn the hard way because personally, I'm not a process guy. I'm a visionary and I just like fly by the seat of my pants. But I've realized that that doesn't work for, you know, 90% of the population. And there has to be preset expectations and consistency, et cetera. And so I'm a huge fan of traction and EOS. If I had found traction in the EOS process 23 years ago or whenever it was that I started really venturing into this, I've often said this, I'm a visionary and my first business partner was an integrator. We just didn't know that language. We were amazing together, but we were also really bad when it was really bad. And it's because we didn't have that framework and expectation. And it's not just the visionary and the integrator, it's that process for the entire organization. And so if we had to come down to one single thing that I think every business from the size of, you know, 8 or 10 employees to, I think they say 250 should integrate in their organization, it's probably traction and EOS. That would be probably the one thing that has really changed our organization in the last couple of years. I have an implementer, her name's Jessica, that, you know, we work with consistently. I'm trying to get her on the podcast because it's so powerful. But I love EOS. You know, you mentioned virtual assistants. Our team, we have a team of probably 50, 55 employees, but we utilize virtual assistants and we use a company called MOD. It's a GoBundance brother named Daniel Ramsey.
Daniel Ramsey.
You know, really, and that's, again, that's a person, but also their process is so amazing for, you know, bolting on and helping us. But again, I don't want to get too off on a tangent. I think EOS would be the number one process and system. Obviously there's a ton, you know, rent manager and we use Asana and all the tools that we use, but I think it all comes back to having a centralized operating system that your team can speak the same language, be organized around. It doesn't have to be EOS, but a lot of times I think what happens is we try to implement too many different internal operating systems. And I think that's probably part of the challenge. And so EOS has kind of streamlined that for us.
Right. Exactly. Now it sounds like you're a visionary and one of the visionary's most important roles is finding the right people that understand the vision of your company. Can you tell us a little bit about how you know when you found the right hire or when you're looking for people, what is it that you're looking for that maybe matches with your values and the company's values and their values? Would love it. Maybe this is something that's covered in traction, but I just want to hear your take on it as well.
Yeah. And it's definitely covered in traction, but again, traction is a process. And I think a lot of times, especially as visionaries, we're like, you know, how do I condense this 3 or 4 or 5 year process down into like 3 months?
Yeah.
And it's really just not, it's not doable. It is covered in there. And I think the key to that, and you already mentioned values, but I think the hardest thing for us is really values are not a set of words that are on a wall. It's like, how do we get to the point where, you know, we're going to create this system of values that we're really going to live by and they're consistent. And so getting that narrowed down is one thing, but then it's really hard to flush out. I read a Harvard study that said it takes 8 months for even the best of the best employees to really get settled into their job and be performing at peak. So 8 months is like kind of minimum. And so when you think about that from a values perspective, that's like a process and job description, you know, perspective. When you think of it from a values perspective, it's really challenging and I think it takes time. So one of the things, I'll give you a few practical. For me, it's about energy and alignment. And honestly, I used to feel bad about saying this, but if I don't like being around you and I don't feel energized, and now this is not every single day, all day, because we all have down days and everything else, but that's my first values filter. Like, can I see myself working with this individual day in, day out? And then as they start, you know, interviewing and working with the team, same filter. And we've got some words that, you know, really, I mean, do we bring high energy? Do we bring commitment? These are the things that, and again, they're not just things that we put on a wall, because when things get hard, that's when you really see the writing on the wall with people. It's not in the good times, it's in the bad times. And, you know, the last couple of years have really, I'll tell you one thing I'm proud of after the last couple of years, our team, we had to make cuts and changes just like everybody else during COVID, but the team that's with me right now has been with me, you know, some of them have been with me for over 10 years in other businesses and organizations, but the team that we have currently today has made it through, you know, some really challenging times the last couple of years. And I think it's because of making sure that we're aligned around those culture fits, that, you know, the internal values, and they're different for everybody. But for me, that's really my filter number one. Like, do we see ourselves working with this individual day in and day out? Do they bring a positive energy? Because again, all of us, I have a pretty positive energy, but I'll tell you what, when things are tough, you'll see the worst of the worst in anybody. And that's the time that you want to make sure that your team is flourishing.
You said there was energy and alignment is the two things that you look for, right? Are both of those things that you mentioned, is that covering both of them? I just wanted to make sure we hit both those things there with that.
Yeah, well, there's a couple others. I mean, so energy is part of it, like bringing a positive energy. That's actually our word. Alignment around the mission, which that's more of a long-term thing, but you can see that part of that is a resume thing, but part of it is also, do you buy into the vision? Can you see where we're going? And that's part of the filtering process up front, being in alignment. How is somebody going to know if they're in alignment with you if they don't get the vision? So I think being slow on the hiring side is important. Curiosity is a big, another one for us that I didn't throw out there, but I think remaining curious, it gets us out of roadblock a lot of times, because when we just look at a problem, whether it's an employee, whether it's a business owner, a manager, it doesn't matter. When we just look at the problem and we stop right there, that's a lack of curiosity about, okay, well, I used to get so frustrated about this when one of my technicians would come back when they were in the field and they'd say, I couldn't solve the problem. Well, who's going to solve the problem if you don't solve it? Like, why didn't you get curious, ask questions, call me, accelerate the problem? Because if you don't solve the issue, they're going to call another company out. And that curiosity is what keeps us engaged. And it sounds weird, but when you come up against a problem that you can't solve, we have to get curious and we have to start asking questions. Okay, if we can't solve this through the current thought process, how do we escalate this to the next level? And if it's something I can't solve, being curious about, okay, who could help me solve this? And how do we brainstorm about it? And so curiosity is another big one for us.
Very cool. It sounds like these values and everything, I think I'm understanding what you mean by alignment in your words, because you're trying to express all of these things on a day-to-day basis. Like, you got to have the energy, the openness, the curiosity, the engagement, that all has to be there on a day-to-day basis. And if this employee, right, that came to you and said, I don't know how to solve, they clearly missed something. And I can tell that if this happens over a consistent period of time, then you're creating this culture, right? Which is so hard to create, a culture of people that stick together and help each other out, right? And you're really creating this incredible microcosm of that. So obviously you've done this before. What advice do you have for people who are starting out that maybe only have a couple employees early on? Are there things that people can do in preparation for scaling to help get this lined up to be ready for that type of business that comes on in team?
You know, there's my brain just went like three different directions because I want to give something tactical. But I think the first thing, again, especially I shouldn't say especially because it matters all the way through, but being in alignment at a small scale, one of our other things is teamwork. And, you know, following up teamwork, it's everyone's job. And that again comes back to, you know, a part of just everybody jumping in. And so for somebody that's got a smaller organization, I think it's more important at a small scale that you get these things filtered out for you. And for me, it's like, you know, when you've got a small group of people, a lot of times they're working harder, there's more stress. Getting those back-end processes is extremely important, but getting aligned around the mission and getting everybody together is super important. So I don't know that this becomes less valuable, but I think at an early phase or stage, I think you really need to spend a lot of time with your core team members, a lot, because that's how you're going to flush out things. That's where, you know, they're going to have a lot of ideas that you maybe are not seeing on a daily basis and that kind of stuff. And so when organizations are smaller and growing, I think being really connected is even more important. And I'm not saying it's not important when we start to scale, but you're going to start seeing that, like right now, it's really important in my organization for me to be really connected to three people. My CEO, his name's Tyler, my business partner, Andrew, and my controller, Lisa. And so again, I kind of look at that as my small group. And if you're, you know, a small business just getting started, whether it's your VA or, you know, a couple of core team members, I really believe at the end of the day that one person, especially me, and this might not apply to everybody, but the fact that I'm a visionary and not very, you know, organized and process driven, I can really only, when I start getting to six or seven people that are, you know, my core team, I start getting really overloaded. And so that's been kind of a base measurement for me. When I start getting to that, it's really time for me to scale and bring in another level.
I love that. Now, just out of curiosity, are you allowing your core team to start affecting the values that you have as a company? Or is this something where you're like, this is my company, these are the values that I want, and let's figure out a way to make it work together? Or do you actually give them input to help affect the vision and the direction of the company? Because not all companies stay the same for a long time, right? Like if, for instance, if Toyota, if you read a book, the book Good to Great, right? The company Toyota, they ended up winning because their vision was big enough and broad enough because of input from their core team to say that we should be in the, not in the car business, we need to be in the business of helping move things, right? Of transportation. And you know, now they're diversified into almost every type of transportation business there is. So I guess going back to the question, how much input do you allow your core team members to have into the entire vision for the company itself?
Huge, huge amount of input.
Okay.
So I'll say this real quick. Good to Great, by the way, classic, probably top five books. Yeah. The hedgehog concept transformed my first business. Probably read that a year into it. And that whole concept really set apart. So just a little side note there. As far as input, here's what I love about the EOS process. And this will answer your question. So I think a lot of business owners think that, well, let's go into our annual planning and, you know, we get our values on the wall and all that kind of stuff. And then it's done. The reality with EOS, and this is why I was saying it's a commitment to the time process. You really bring your core leadership team in with EOS, and that's probably a 1 to 2 year process, depending on how fast you move through it. And then you start moving it down through the organization. We built our values as a team. When I first started doing EOS, I self-implemented. EOS has some tools called Basecamp, which gives you all the tools that an implementer would basically come in and take your team through. So we started self-implementing, but what I realized was I couldn't be objective because I'm an equal on the team. And that's when, you know, after about 7 months, we decided to bring in an implementer, which, you know, costs somewhere between $5,000 and $8,000 a session, depending on, you know, who you're working with, because everybody needs to be objective and we all need to be an equal voice. And the fact that I'm the leader of the organization and also trying to lead and implement EOS was a challenge for me because I think everybody needs to have an equal voice. And the thing that I love about EOS is that we're all created equal. Doesn't matter what your title is. Yes, there's an organizational chart. They call it an accountability chart. Yes, there's an accountability chart, but we're all equals in this organization. And so the answer to your question is, yes, it's an iteration that's constantly happening. As a leadership team, we built that together and then we start rolling it through the organization. But also we're constantly iterating. You're reviewing those, and there's a process around all this too, but you're constantly reviewing, are our core values still in alignment? We're constantly asking. In fact, you constantly have a scoring methodology in EOS around the values. And so they keep it pretty simple, but does this person get it? Do they get it, want it? And do they have the capacity to do it? So GWC. And then there's a values formula that we rank against, right? Anyway, I'm kind of getting in the weeds on the process of it, but yes, the answer is it's a constant iteration and the team has total input. And as you go through the L10 process and weekly meetings, we have our, we call it the PPC leadership team, a level 10 meeting. And then each division kind of has its own L10 meeting as well as you roll that through. But again, this is a 1 to 3 year process. So it's not like you just, as visionaries, we want to just roll it out and it's be prepared for the long game because it is a long game.
Yeah, these things go at the very core of what it is to be in business and the people behind them, right? Which is just as important as the business itself, because in the end, we're all doing business with each other and we're serving other people as well, you know, when it comes down to it. So everything is all people-based and I completely get that there. And I have so many follow-up questions here, but I have to move on to some other topics that I want to hit on too while we're here. And one of that concerns also people, because that seems like a very good talent of yours, is that you're able to basically surround yourself around the most incredible people. I know that that's not on accident, right? You just don't walk into that. That's either something you do on intentionally, or you're seeking it out, or you're getting help. Can I ask you, you know, how it is that you've been able to do that, to surround yourself around some incredible people and then draw them towards you over time? Like, what is it that you do, or how do you think about that in terms of either seeking people out or just being there to serve others? I want to hear your process on this, and if you have anything at all.
So this was probably 2005 as well. I started the plumbing and heating company, and I looked around and I was like, okay, well, which one of my competitors is not selling us, which brand is not being represented in my market? And it was Trane, the HVAC company Trane. And so I reached out, I became a Trane dealer, and my territory rep, her name was Andrea Coleman. She taught me a ton. I need to reach out to her and tell her how much she actually taught me. You know, it was because of her that I got connected with BDR. We became a Trane comfort specialist, and I learned so much through that process. It's another example of who. But anyway, the reason why I'm saying that, she made a comment. She said, you're always hiring. And, you know, GE has this process where, you know, every year they would literally fire a bottom certain percentage of their employees and then bring on new employees. And I think there's a kind of a mix there between always hiring. I'm always looking for talent. Every conversation that I'm getting into, I'm thinking through a lens of, you know, is this a potential partner? I'm making mental catalogs. And I believe our this is where we get a little woo-woo on this, but I believe our subconscious is so powerful. If you know what you're looking for, and for me, if I had to narrow it down to one thing, which is the question you're asking, it's people. And so if you're constantly looking for people, then your subconscious is constantly keeping a catalog of, you know, that interaction, that type of person. And this goes back to the person that's talking too much at the table, by the way, because if I'm talking all the time and I'm not trying to understand, you know, what drives Derek, what really it motivates him, I'm not going to be able to catalog at some point in time when I can connect you with the right person, or you're the right person in my life or whatever. And so I think it's mentally cataloging that, you know, first and foremost is the most important thing, truly being curious around, you know, who are those individuals. But to bring it back to Andra, she was saying you're always hiring. And so, you know, I would say when you find the right human, like, do everything you can to potentially get them on board. And I'll tell you one, as a real estate person, also talking about humans, this is crazy because a lot of your listeners are probably real estate people, I'm guessing. Here's the thing. If I told you, hey, Derek, if you invest $100,000 in this asset, it'll bring you $10,000 or $15,000 a year. You know, it's a 10 or 15 or 20% return. You'd do that all day long. Like, that sounds like a great investment. I'm going to get tax benefits, all the above. That's awesome. The minute I say to you, Derek, invest $100,000 in this person and they're going to bring you a $10,000 or a $15,000 return every year, our brain goes, whoa.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and this is why we love real estate. It's tangible. It's consistent. We can count on it. Humans are different. They're not tangible. They're not necessarily consistent. We can't always count on it. So the more we can create that filter in our life to figure out, you know, how do we narrow down to try to find people that are consistent that we can count on? And it's through those conversations. Like, if I've talked to you and known you for 3 or 4 years and I've watched your track record and I'm taking this mental catalog in the back of my mind, and then all of a sudden I'm looking for a human, I'm like, oh, Derek, I've watched him. He's consistent. I can count on him. He's credible. All of these things, right? And so I know that's not a simple, you know, something you can just plug into a CRM. One of my mentors, Dan Sullivan, always says the eyes only see and the ears only hear what the brain is looking for. It's that reticular activator conversation. And I'm just looking for good humans. I'm looking for connection and I'm looking for talent.
Man, there's so much gold here, Mike. Thank you so much for sharing all this. A lot of this stuff is things that you inherently know, but to hear someone like you that's implementing it, to listen to the way that you're saying this makes total sense to me. And I think that this is something that for some reason I haven't been doing up to now. So again, thank you for sharing all this. Is really great stuff here. Hopefully all these listeners out there are listening to the advice that you're giving. And one thing that I would add on to this, and I'd love your thoughts too, is that maybe you're at a point right now where you don't think you're in business, but you really are. You're always going to be in business for yourself. As long as you understand that you cannot depend on your W-2, that's a whole nother conversation. So that's something that, you know, you got to help yourself with. And as soon as you can find something that you're really passionate about and you want to jump into to help serve others, you're going to always be in business for yourself and for your family. And even if it's someone that you're not going to hire, maybe you want to find someone to partner up with, right? Mike, you mentioned that you're a big fan of partnering, and I am as well. Maybe you'll find someone that really impresses you And maybe you want to jump onto their rocket ship with them, grab a seat on their rocket ship, right? So this philosophy of you're thinking that, oh, you know, this isn't for me because I'm not a business person yet. I really encourage you listeners out there to think again, because what you're saying, Mike, is that you're one person away from solving the problems that you even never thought you had in the first place.
Yeah, I love it. And I completely agree with it. Number one. Number two, I'll just throw out one more little filter that I use all the time. I'm constantly looking at my energy level. So we're talking about energy with the people that are around us, but we have to get really clear on what brings us energy, what we love. You know, my show Investing for Freedom, that's been the thing that's driven me from the beginning. That's why I surround myself with amazing talent, because there's only a few things that I'm really good at. And so even bringing it back to what you were saying with, you know, a lot of your listeners might be saying, I'm not a business owner or whatever. I think there's a farce that's been sold by gurus in the real estate. The whole idea of, you know, real estate's easy and you're just going to, real estate's a long game, just like building a business is. Building your passive portfolio or active portfolio, wealth building is a long game. Investing in the stock market can be a short game. And yeah, you can make good money in and out and it's quick. But also, like, the majority of people that invest in the stock market are looking at it as a long game. That's how we need to think about real estate too. And so when we bring it back into what we're really talking about here, I think what you just said is extremely important, because even if you don't want to build a small or a large business, the same principles apply. Like, who am I going to team up with and what vendors can I bring into my life? And honestly, here's a great little example. My assistant that I hired in 2007 became my property manager. Ultimately, she was my assistant in my business, but then she started managing my properties. When I sold that business in 2014, she came with me and she continued to manage my properties in Nevada. And then she started scaling. She was doing my bookkeeping. We taught her how to be a bookkeeper. She now owns a consulting company called Stanfield Consulting. She has like 25 employees. She's skilled. Wow. I'm so proud of her. But guess who still manages my properties and does all my personal bookkeeping? Elizabeth does, through Stanfield Consulting. My point in saying that was, like, even if you just want to be a professional investor, which she handles all of my stuff on the professional investing side, she doesn't do anything with my businesses. But even if you just want to be a professional investor, hopefully you're going to scale to a point where you need to start outsourcing, whether it's a vendor or an assistant internally or whatever. And so again, it's the same principle like you were talking about. Even if you want to be a passive investor and you love your W-2 job, which, by the way, I'm a huge fan of the W-2. Not everybody needs to be an entrepreneur. Not everybody needs to be a business owner. Not everybody needs to scale a real estate organization. So if you love your W-2 job, and that's, I've said this for a long time, make as much fake money as you can and invest it in real assets. So if you love your W-2 job, stay right there. It's all good.
Yeah. Yeah. I love it. At least partner with people who know what they're doing, and then that'll help. That'll get you there just as fast, right? The point is to be in alignment with you, your family, and what gives you energy, right? And I think that just making it full circle here, Mike, going all the way back to the energy piece of this, right? What is it, not only with the people you're working with, but with what you're doing with your life, that's feeding you and giving you energy, right? To do what you're doing from day to day. And being intuitive and super sensitive to that is going to serve you in heaps and bounds. And one thing too, Mike, that I keep saying that I want to add something on top of this, because it's just gold, but the awareness piece of your energy. Let's say that you're standing in line in Starbucks, right? And there's that one employee that serves you every day. Like, you know, you go to the same Starbucks, let's say you're a coffee drinker, and you go there and you notice that employee that just, there's something about that employee that you just, like, you really think that there's a ton of potential there. Yep. That could be your next partner. That could be someone that works with you. That could be someone that eventually you could work for. Who knows, right? It's just a matter of stepping into that and just coming from a point of true value and curiosity. So I just love everything that you're saying there, Mike. I think it's super powerful for people to listen to this.
That's that cataloging in the back of your brain, right?
Yeah.
Never know. And that alignment around the energy is important too. And I think I was having a conversation with Brian Lubin this morning just about this. And I think being conscious and aware of that energy, if you get energized by going to Starbucks for an hour every morning, and that's where you're like, you know, your brain is like growing and you're getting the vision and everything else. And then all of a sudden you find yourself in a place where you're so busy that you can't do that anymore. You need to think about, that's the check-in on that energy level and what brings you alignment. Because if you can outsource, you're so busy and you're buried in your business that you can no longer go do that 1 hour thing that brings you energy, find a VA or somebody that can take 1 hour off of you and get back to it. There's really only one or two or three things that I'm really good at, and I try to focus on that.
Yeah. And obviously it served you very well, Mike, because you manage a lot of assets, and you have a lot of team members and people that look to you for advice and are helping each other out. And you just built a really strong culture. So just want to commend you on all of the things that you've built over a long, consistent, steady track record. It takes a lot of time and effort to move the flywheel, but once it's going, now it's kind of like, I don't want to say fun and games, because there's always down days and there's always up days, but I'm just really impressed with what you've built in the short time that I've known you through GoBundance. It's really fun to watch you grow. So I just want to say that there.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah. So one last question that I have for you before we enter into the rapid round, which is the same five questions that we ask every one of our guests on the show, is a very tactical based one, because I'm really into tactical things, because if I can do the things that you do, that kind of bleeds into being and thinking the same way that you do. And my question is, what do your morning and or evening routines look like?
You know, I've gone back and forth on this. I think you're going to hear a common thread that I've been saying throughout this. I'm not a process guy.
Okay. Yeah.
I actually think that the evening routine is something that I'm really working on right now, because I like to stay up late, and therefore you don't get up as early. And I am a morning person too, which this is crazy. My wife jokes around and laughs about this, but early on I would stay out, you know, after church, like literally we'd stay out after church till 1-2 o'clock in the morning with everybody. And then I go to work I'd have to get up at 4 a.m. As I get older, that's not healthy and it's not good, but I can survive on a limited amount of sleep, and I'm trying to get away from that. So I'm trying to put boundaries on the evening. Like, honestly, I'm trying to go to bed by 10. I have to like force myself to get in bed by 10, which sets me up for a better morning. Honestly, I like just kind of not a consistent, I love David Osborne's book, Miracle Morning for Millionaires. And I've implemented a portion of that, but I don't have a consistent routine where I'm like, I have to do these 8 or 10 things every single morning. To me, it's kind of fluid. I love connecting with people in the morning. Morning, I probably connected with 4 or 5 different people. I'm very fluid. And like I was saying earlier about just being kind of open to the process and what gives me energy, I really try to connect in the morning. I try to get a little bit of workout in, but honestly, that's another area that I'm really escalating my health to the top, because as I get older, it's not been a priority and I'm working on that now. So to me, it's fluid though. It's really trying to connect. I do read most of the time. You know, a lot of it's some thinking time. I love Keith Cunningham's whole process around thinking time. I usually do get some meditation in, but it's throughout the day. So a lot of the things that people would do in a morning routine, I'm stopping when my energy levels, I'm very cognizant of my energy level, and I'll stop and I'll meditate for 10 or 15 minutes, and that'll trigger it back. Sometimes I'm reading throughout the day. So a lot of the things that people would normally do in a chunk in the morning, I do throughout the day.
Okay. That's good advice. I think it's more about intuition. And I think that that's what I really respect about, you know, your approach to business, is that you're using your intuition and how you feel to help guide some of the decisions that you make. Obviously, you're doing due diligence and you're making all of these things that need to happen. But the big decisions that really matter a lot, whether it's day to day or whether it's a hire that you're making, I get the feeling that you're using your intuition and your energy and, you know, whether things kind of feel right, just because you've been there, like you've done a lot of things before, and you're trusting in yourself to do that. And that also applies to your morning routine, which I very much respect. And I think for me, I do the same thing as well. I'm just looking for, you know, common patterns, or if there's anything that you absolutely don't go without, to make sure that I'm doing whatever that is so I can follow in your footsteps there.
Yeah. I think for me, it's just coffee and tea and some thinking time. That would be I can't go without that.
Got it. That sounds great. Well, hey, Mike, this has been awesome. I could sit here and talk with you for hours on all of the stuff and ask you a million questions, and really appreciate your time here. We're going to head into the rapid round, which is the same 5 questions that we ask every one of our guests, and they're meant to be answered in about 30 seconds or less. So if you're ready, we'll head into it.
Yep.
All right. Cool. Number one, what book has had the biggest impact on you and why? And we ask that it not be the Bible or the Purple Bible, which is Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
Richest Man in Babylon. Read it over and over and over. And it's simple. It's timely principles. My very wealthy uncle gave it to me with a $20 bill and a $2 bill in the front. And, you know, it took me probably 1.5-2 years to break into that, but it's one of those books that I guarantee I've read 120 times, and I'm taking it on my trip to Lake Powell next week to read it again.
It's fantastic. I also love the audiobook version of that too, as well. But yeah, I think that's a super powerful read. Do you give that also to your kids, or is there any kind of gifting that you do with this book too?
I give it to a lot of people. I've given it as graduation gifts with a 20 and a 2, just like my uncle did for me. And I love it.
That's cool, man. Great book. Number two, if people wanted to emulate your success, what is the first actionable thing that they could do right now to follow in your footsteps?
Get really clear on what it is you really want and why you want it. Because, you know, the avenue you take, the methodology, I just told my daughter this. She's 18 and graduating. She's my youngest. I'm still trying to figure out what I want to be when I grow up. So we take it too seriously about, you know, what it's going to be in the long-term commitment. Just figure out what you want, why you want it, and then always be open to adjusting, because your desires are going to change. The world's going to change. Everything's going to change.
That's huge. Right there is just, if you guys are listening right now, those two sentences are well worth the entire time for listening to this podcast. Thank you very much, Mike. That was awesome. Big stuff. Number three, what one tool, process, or hack in the last 3 months that you've implemented helps save you time and or effort right now in your personal or your business life?
Asana, project management tool, and really turning that over to, you know, my operations manager, because I don't spend a lot of time in there. She does most of it.
But you're seeing a lot of things, like you're seeing more visibility. You know, you're kind of able to, if you have any questions, you can go in there and look at things, or you can just talk with them and trust that they're using it well, right?
And actually a step for yes to that, but also it's eliminating a lot of the things that I don't need to see and a place to capture it.
Awesome. Okay. Number four, if the people that you know had to describe you with one word, what do you think that word would be?
Compassionate.
Yeah, I could see that. I kind of got that feeling when I first met you in person out in Austin. So very, very cool. And number five, last question, what small thing do most people not know about you? This question is particularly hard for podcasters because, you know, things come out.
Yeah, there's a lot. I like to dry age beef.
That's cool. I love that. That's neat. So where do you get that? Like, do you hunt it, or like, how does that whole thing start?
Yeah. So I've got a dry ager just right over there. And, you know, I mean, I buy whole primals, like, you know, whole kind of like a, it'd be like a prime rib, but I buy the whole ribs in New York's, et cetera, and just age them. And then, yeah, I'm an avid hunter too.
That's cool. So there's a science behind that too, right? You got to like season it, and there's a certain like heat, and I don't know.
Humidity, I'm just temperature. Wondering. It's all very important.
Very cool. All right. Awesome. Well, hey, Mike, thank you so much for coming on the show. But before we go, why don't you tell the listeners a little bit more about how they can find out what's going on in your world, or maybe work with you or work for you? How can people reach out?
Yeah. So I think first and foremost, the Investing for Freedom podcast, probably one of my favorite things I've ever done. And it's because we get to connect. This is why I love it. We just get to connect with amazing people. So, you know, go find the show Investing for Freedom. It's on any of the platforms that you listen to. And then the other thing, just text me 480-531-7519. Great, great place to connect.
Awesome. Mike, thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. We had a blast, and man, people are going to take away a lot of wisdom from the show. So thank you for coming on.
Yeah. Thanks for having me, man. Been looking forward to it.
Absolutely. And for you listeners out there who've listened all the way to this point, I want to thank you as well. So please, wherever you're listening or watching this, please like, subscribe, comment, just engage with us in general, so that way we can appease the algorithm gods and get more and more exposure to other listeners, and also to be able to allow other guests to come on, just like Mike, and continue to add value to many, many folks out there. So once again, thank you so much for listening. And Mike, really appreciate you coming on. It's been a blast. This is Derek signing off.